Greetings. This is part 6, reviewing an Islamic poem titled, O Christ Worshippers. The author Ibn Qayyim lived from 1292 to 1350. Was he the first to imagine his arguments? Probably not. Islam has not listened to the answers for at least 700 years. But Muslims who have listened have probably followed the truth. Let's get to the next refrain and see what awaits an answer. How could the rods stand to bear the true Lord when he was fastened? How could the irons reach him and had his body pinned? This is an interesting question because it ascribes awareness to inanimate objects. How could the rods stand to bear the true Lord when he was fastened? And I am not mocking such a question, because the Word of God first revealed that such objects may indeed have awareness. Let us look at what the prophets have said. Zechariah 9:9, Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion! Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem! Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation, humble and mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The King of the Jews is coming, riding a donkey, even the foal of a donkey. Now, to be totally skeptical and brutally honest, this is a prophecy any man could attempt to fill. They only need to ride a donkey into Jerusalem and then claim they are the fulfillment, right? And if riding a donkey was the only mention of the King of the Jews, it would be simple to fake. Matthew 2:1. Now Jesus, having been born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, asking, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him. The Magi, who were wise men and astronomers, knew from the signs in the heavens a king had been born. If the stars led them to the first coming of our Lord, the King of the Jews, might there now be signs as well for his second coming? So beside the action, riding a donkey, that the coming king would fulfill, there must have been some other indications. And while a grown man can fake a fulfillment riding a donkey, a baby cannot fake having a star lead wise men to his birth. But I do not want to go too far afield from the central point and the question from the poem. What about the inanimate rods that hung the Messiah from the cross? The reason I raise Prophet Zechariah's message is that Jesus the Messiah references the message and in fact fulfills it. Matthew 21:1, as they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent out 2 disciples. Go to the village ahead of you, he told them, and at once you will find a donkey tied there and her colt beside her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone questions you, tell him that the Lord, Kyrios, needs them, and he will send them right away. The Greek word Kyrios can mean master, but also typically means God, as in the angel of the Lord, Kyrios. Can we logically assume this means God and not simply master? I think so. If challenged and they said, the Lord needs them, the owner would rightly say, who is your master? And maybe say no. But I suspect, as with all other details, the Lord had arranged for the owner's cooperation by some other method or messenger. Matthew 21:4. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. Clearly the Messiah knew of the prophecy and was fulfilling it. So the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and laid their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A massive crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna is a transliteration of Hosiana, which is a cry to save now. Psalm 118:25, O Yahweh, Lord, do save, we beseech you. O Yahweh, Lord, we beseech you, do send prosperity. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Psalm 118:26, blessed is the one who comes in the name of Yahweh, the Lord. We have blessed you from the house of Yahweh, the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Psalm 118:26, praise Yahweh, the Lord. Praise Yahweh, the Lord, from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. The praise they were offering up to Jesus was praise Prophet David described for God. Now in Luke, there is a detail recorded of this event that is on point with the topic from the poem. Luke 19:38, shouting, blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. But some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. If the praise was directed toward God, no rebuke would have been offered. Clearly, the direction of the praise was offensive or of concern to the Jewish leaders. And answering, he, Jesus, said, I say to you that if these will be silent, the stones will cry out. Jesus himself says if the people stop worshiping him, the stones will cry out, meaning worship him. That indicates that inanimate matter may worship the God who made them. And one further evidence that nature, the universe, or creation may not be simple inanimate atoms. Romans 8:19, for the earnest expectation of the creation awaits the revelation of the sons of God. Expectation is an attribute of mind and awareness. Creation itself waits for the sons of God to be manifested. How could the rods stand to bear the true Lord when he was fastened? The rods or nails could stand to hold him because that was their task. Just as angels stand by, the plan requires the nails to hold the crucified body of the Messiah. Plan, command, and obedience. How could the irons reached him and had his body pinned? The irons or nails did not need to reach into heaven, as the poet imagines. God came in the flesh to earth. Malachi 3:1, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. And more precisely, God came to make himself subject to death on the cross. Philippians 2:5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to cling to, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being made in human likeness. Jesus emptied himself of the glory he possessed as God. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. This was not so God could learn what death felt like, as I have heard some postulate. Messiah came to die for the sins of his people, as the prophets foretold. Daniel 9:26, "And after 62 weeks shall Messiah be cut off, but not for himself." Isaiah 53:8, "He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken." So also Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many, and he will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. And could nails hold God if God did not want it to happen? No, and Islam even has the very word, Inshallah. Why are Muslims willing to accept any catastrophe and fatalistically dismiss it as Inshallah? But when events transpire that were foretold by the prophets, there is total blindness. Inshallah, it is the will of Satan they are blind. How could his enemy's hands reach him and slap his rear? But emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he, Jesus, God in the flesh, humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. It is critical you grasp the plan of God, which no man can stop. Even the experiences on the cross were foretold by the prophets of Yahweh God. Psalm 22:6, "But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people." Isaiah 53:3, "He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hid their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." There are literally hundreds of prophecies foretold by the prophets that Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, fulfilled. And was Christ revived by himself, or was the reviver another God? This is an example of a logical false choice. Either Christ raised himself, or another separate God, who was not dead, raised him. And this is another example of ignorance of the Trinity, whereby God in the flesh could die, and God the Father, who is a spirit, could remain on his throne in heaven. But there is an aspect of this question that is actually quite profound. This is not a topic that can be easily dismissed because of what Jesus himself said. John 10:18, "No one has taken it away from me, but I lay it down of my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father." Does this cause any problems for Christian doctrine? Not really. Jesus sometimes referred to the Trinity in ways that revealed who he was. Jesus is one with the Father. Therefore, if the Father raised Jesus, Jesus is tacitly raising himself by his oneness. John 14:9, Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" It takes great effort to confuse one's self and deny what Jesus clearly stated. Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say then, "Show us the Father"? One must think, Jesus didn't really mean what you think those words mean. Have we learned that the questions of the poem from 700 years ago cannot be answered? I do not think so. In fact, I think we learn that Islam's confusion arises from ignorance of the message of the prophets. O Muslim, if you claim you respect the prophets, do you want to know what that message really was? This is the choice and challenge you face, brother. Do you love God? Do you love truth? I find Muslims, when asked, will answer yes to both such questions, but cannot answer yes to the next question. Do you love them more than Muhammad? O Muslim, seek God and worship God, and desire to learn the message God sent by the prophets. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.